الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الرحمن علم القرآن، خلق الإنسان، علمه البيان، الشمس والقمر بحسبان، والنجم والشجر يسجدان، والسماء رفعها ووضع الميزان، ألا تطغوا في الميزان، وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان، والأرض وضعها للأنام، فيها فاكهة والنخل ذات الأكمام، والحب ذو العصف والريحان، فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher and protector. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we meet once again with the tawfiq of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue this beautiful journey with his glorious names and attributes. It is only through his tawfiq, and it is incumbent upon us to thank him for accepting us and choosing us to delve into this great science. For it is only through this science that we can understand the greatness and the grandeur of our Creator. For the more we understand the greatness and the grandeur of our Creator, the more we turn towards him, the more we love him, the more we understand him, the more we would want to attain the stages of wilaya. Allahu Akbar. The more we would want to draw closer and closer to our beloved maker. And that would make us from the friends of Allah the Almighty. That would make us from the awliya of Allah the Almighty. Today's khutbah, my topic was in regard to the friends of Allah and the friends of shaitan. I based it mostly on a book, an immersive book written by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah in regard to the friends of Allah and the friends of Shaytan. It is available in English and you can find it, I think, at Dar Salaam and publishers likewise. It is a fantastic read and I advise all of you to read it, to know the distinguishing factors between the friends of Allah and the friends of shaitan. May Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from his friends and save us all from becoming the friends of shaitan. For the awliya of Allah, they are the ones who have attained success in this world and the hereafter. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to wilaya, same thing. Awliya is derived from wilaya. In regard to wilaya, it is all about love. Primarily the meaning of wilaya is love, friendship, closeness to Allah the Almighty. Love is something that is incorporated, it is programmed within every single human being. You see people loving their children, loving their wives, loving their parents. You see animals loving one another. This is something incorporated within each and every human being. But my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the perfect love. We hear stories, Romeo and Juliet, Layla and Majnun. Good things to pass time. But the perfect love is the love of Allah the Almighty. Unparalleled love. For Allah is Al-Wadud, the most loving, the most affectionate. And it is only through the love of Allah can a slave of Allah attain success in this world and the hereafter. And one of the laws, one of the most important laws of love is what? You love what your beloved one loves. You love what your beloved one loves. I don't know how things are with marriages these days, but if you really love your wife, you would love exactly what she loves. You would want to dress up the way she wants you to dress. You would want to wear the perfume, wear the fragrance that she likes. You want to behave in a way that would please her. This is what love is all about. Likewise, the wife would want to dress in a manner that would please her husband. Win the love of her husband and not the men on the street. See, if that is the case with the creation, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, what about Allah the Almighty? Our beloved Maker who created us, who fashioned us, who brought us to what we are today. If we love Him, if we claim to love Him, we would do every single thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to do. We would beautifully comply to the commandments of Allah the Almighty. The speech of Allah, the Quran. Today the Quran has become an ornament in our houses. But it is the speech of our beloved Allah the Almighty. Loved ones, they read the letters that they receive from their from the ones they have fallen in love with or their beloved ones with so much of care, so much of attention. But what about the kalam of Allah? What about the speech of Allah? How much of emotion, how much of a connection must we have when we recite the noble Quran? It's not all about flipping pages and waiting till the juz, the chapter ends or the surah ends. How many more pages have I got to finish the surah? How many more pages have I got to finish the juz? Okay, I recite the Surah Al-Kahf, it's over. It is as if a burden has been removed. It is not a burden. It is the speech of our beloved. This is what love is all about, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And from that stems the two names that we are going to start our journey with today. Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. Allahu Akbar. Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to the names of Allah the Almighty, you see, take the name Kareem for example. Kareem or Rahim, you see, you can name a human being Kareem, which would mean a noble person, a generous person, Kareem. You can name a person Rahim, which would mean merciful. Likewise, you could even name a person Khaliq. In some sense, scholars are of the opinion, they differ here in regard to the name Khaliq. Some say that the meaning of the word Khaliq, originator, creator, one who creates from nothing. Allah the Almighty, He created us from nothing. Allah created Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, our father, out of nothing. He does not need raw materials to get to a final product. That is the meaning of Khaliq. But you could also give another meaning to Khaliq, which means manufacture, using raw materials. You have invented something, you have created something. Say you built a house, it could mean Khaliq too there. So you could, this name You can apply it to human beings also. But Ar-Rahman is a name which is specific to Allah the Almighty. Two names, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, two names from the Asma of Allah, from the glorious names and attributes of Allah, two names cannot be applied on a human being or any creation for that matter. And these two names, we all know the first one, Allah. This is a name specific to Allah the Almighty. None can share this name. None can be ascribed with this name. And likewise, Ar-Rahman, He is Allah. And in Arabic, it is on the scale. There is a scale. You see, you have scales in Arabic, word patterns. Ar-Rahman is on the scale Mubalagha, which shows an exaggeration, which shows a high level of something. For example, you can take words Jaw'an, Jaw'an, which means hungry, but hungry in the sense starving. He is starving. You say Mal'an, full of something. Atushan, he's thirsty in a sense that he's completely parched. He's so thirsty. Ghadban, he's angry. There's no, you can't explain his anger. He's so angry. It is in a superlative form. So likewise, Ar-Rahman, the meaning of Ar-Rahman is that Allah the Almighty is full of His mercy and compassion. This is our beloved Maker, my dear respected elders, brothers in Islam. Ar-Rahman, full of mercy. Full of mercy. But now what about the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim? Both stem from the same root. So what is the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim? Scholars mention that Ar-Rahman, like I said, full of mercy, is something that is general. It encompasses everything. Allah's mercy, it is general. The meaning is general. As for Ar-Rahim, same meaning. Mercy, compassion, same meaning. But Allah the Almighty, He says in the Noble Quran, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. As for Rahim, as for Ar-Rahim, it is a specific name and attribute of Allah the Almighty, which is confined and restricted only for the believers. Only for the believers. Only for the mu'minun. But as for Ar-Rahman, that rahmah, that mercy is general. Whether you're a Muslim or whether you're a non-Muslim, whether you be a human or non-human, that rahmah covers every single creation of His. And that is why He is known as Ar-Rahman. But as for Ar-Rahim, it is specific and confined for the believers alone. The angels, they say in, I think they are the angels who carry the arsh of Allah the Almighty. They say, رَبَّنَا وَسِعْتَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ رَحْمَةٍ. The ayah, they say, Allah the Almighty, His rahmah has encompassed every single creation of His. Every single creation. Likewise, His knowledge. His knowledge and His mercy covers every single creation of His. This is what we mean by Ar-Rahman. And as for the number of times it is mentioned in the Noble Quran, Ar-Rahman is mentioned 57 times and Ar-Rahim is mentioned 114 times. Exactly the opposite of Ar-Rahman. Exactly the opposite of Ar-Rahman. An authentic narration, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that after Allah the Almighty completed the creation, Allah the Almighty ascended over His throne. And on the throne of Allah the Almighty, Allah ascended the throne, كَمَا يَلِيكُ بِشَأْنِهِ وَجَلَالِهِ, in a manner that befits His majesty and His glory. And on the throne of Allah the Almighty, the great and grand throne of Allah the Almighty, there is a writing which is inscribed on it. There is a writing that is inscribed on it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَضَبِي. Allahu Akbar. My mercy overcomes my anger. This is what Allah the Almighty has written on His arsh, on His throne. This is a hadith which Abu Huraira radiallahu anh narrates. Now if we, as we go on this journey, we would understand how merciful our Creator is. So by understanding this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is incumbent upon a believer that he brings this attribute into his life also. For he cannot be a believer if his heart is hard as a rock. He cannot be a believer if there is no mercy and compassion in his heart. If he does not have merciful feeling towards the other creation of Allah the Almighty, he cannot be a believer. He cannot be a believer. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, Irhamu man fil ard, yarhamkum man fis sama. Show mercy towards the ones who are on this earth, the inhabitants of this planet, the human beings. Show mercy to the human beings, show mercy to the animals. يَرْحَمُكُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ The inhabitants of the heavens, including Allah the Almighty, will have mercy upon you. Will have mercy upon you. So, this can only be achieved by you showing your mercy towards one another. By you showing mercy towards the creation of Allah the Almighty. There is a beautiful hadith in regard to the mercy of Allah the Almighty. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, on the day of Qiyamah, a horrifying day, Allah save us all. There is a fine point in regard to Rahmah on that day which I'll mention if I can today. But on that day, a man, a slave of Allah, will be brought in front of Allah the Almighty. And then Allah the Almighty will open his records, Allah save us all. Allah save us all. And Allah make our accounting easy. Allah will open his records and Allah will start with his small sins. Not his major sins, his minor sins. And this slave of Allah is trembling in front of the King of the Kings. Just imagine the day, my dear respected elders. He'll be shivering and trembling. And Allah the Almighty will start mentioning his minor sins. Everything is in a clear record. Whatever we do, every statement of ours, every action of ours is recorded, no doubt. And on that day, everything will be put up on display. Now Allah the Almighty mentions the minor sins of the slave. The slave is trembling. He's trembling, he's shivering. Allah mentions minor sins after minor sins, and then Allah the Almighty stops. The slave now thinks, what about if my major sins now come? I'm finished, I'm destroyed, I'm a goner, I'm going to Jahannam. He's trembling, he's shivering. And then Allah the Almighty, after mentioning his minor sins, Allah will say, look at how merciful our Creator is, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. After mentioning all of his minor sins, Allah the Almighty will say, أَنَسَتَرْتُهَا عَلَيْكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَأَغْفِرُهَا لَكَ الْيَوْمَ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ He will say, O my slave, in this world, in dunya, I covered your sins. You did these sins in the darkness of the night. No one knew about it. In the privacy of your home, in the privacy of your rooms, you committed these sins. No one knew about it. I covered it in dunya. And likewise, on this day, on this horrifying day, I forgive all of your sins. And not only that, I convert, I change all of your sins into good deeds. And now you know what that slave would do. Earlier he was trembling that his major sins should not come out. Now he says, Ya Allah, I also have some of the major sins too. Why? Because now the sins are being turned into good deeds. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when narrating this hadith, when saying the part where the slave of Allah now wishes that his major sins also brought in front, because then Allah will convert that into good deeds. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he smiles. He smiles. He beautifully smiles and narrates this narration to highlight the mercy of our Creator, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. There is another story mentioned in the narration. There was once a man, a sinner. He used to sin perpetually. He used to commit sin after sin. And then he lifts his hand and prays to Allah the Almighty. Ya Allah, Rabbi ighfir li. After committing sins, the malaika who are observing this, they know that he is a person who commits so much of sins. They immediately ask Allah, Ya Allah, this slave of yours is not fit for your mercy, is not fit for your forgiveness. And you know what our beloved Maker says? He says that I am the one. I am Ahlu Taqwa. I am the one who should be feared and who should be, all of them should be conscious of me. Likewise, Huwa Ahlu Taqwa wa Ahlu Al Maghfirah. I am the one who can grant forgiveness. And I will forgive my slave. Allahu Akbar. There was once a man who wanted to go to a particular destination. He had to cross a desert. So he had his caravan with him, a man alone. He looks for a guide to guide him to that location. So a man comes up to him and tells him, I know of a way which is shorter, a shortcut to take you to this location. You pay me this amount, that amount, I'll take you over there. So the man agrees, and this man now guides him, and they're passing a valley now. A valley where there is not a human being to be seen. It is a valley between two mountains. Now as they enter the valley and they're passing through the valley, the man who is going in the caravan, not the guide, he sees skeletons around him. Dead, the remnants of human bodies. He sees bones around him. And then he knows, I walked into a trap. I have walked into a trap. This man has fooled me and now he's going to kill me. He's shivering, he's trembling, he's out of fear. Then the man stops right in the middle of the valley, the guide. He brandishes his sword and comes up to him and says, get down. The man gets down and he says, you know what? I'm a highway robber. I'm going to kill you and take all of your wealth. The man then tells him, Ya Rajul, my man, I have wealth. You can take all of my wealth. Let go of me. Come with me to where I live. I will give you more wealth. Just let go of me because I have children, young children. I have a wife waiting for me. I want to go back to them. The man says, I don't need your wealth at home. This caravan is enough for me. You have enough gold on you. This is enough for me. I am going to kill you. Then the man then says, okay, fine. Just give me time to pray 2 rakat salah. The man says, okay, fine. You can pray 2 rakat salah. But make it fast. Don't delay. The man ties the takbir. And nothing comes to his mind other than the ayah, أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ. This ayah, Allah, He is the one who answers the muttar, the one who is in hardship, the one who is in a difficulty. Allah is the one who answers. وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءُ. He is the one who removes ill. He is the one who removes all evil. He is the one who removes all types of misfortune and calamities. He keeps on repeating this ayah in salah. He's trembling. He fears death. He does not want to die in this valley. He's trembling. Whilst he is in salah, he notices a man rushing in a horse with bright clothes, with a spear in his hand. A knight, a soldier, a kind of a soldier rushing towards where he is praying. The man comes right by him. Now this man finishes his salah and he gives salam, and now he is wondering, now who is he? Has he also come to kill me? That man kills the guide, he pierces the spear through him. And then the man asks him, the man who is making salah, he asks him, who are you and what is your business here? He replies, Ana rasulu man yujibul muntar. I am the messenger of the one who answers you in hardship. Allahu Akbar. I am the messenger of the one who answers you in hardship. And he leaves. He leaves. This is our beloved Maker, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. He is waiting to answer our dua. He is waiting to forgive us. But we, on the other hand, we have forgotten him. We have turned away from him. We have fallen into sin after sin. I mentioned in today's khutbah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that the two ways of attaining wilaya, taqwa and iman, one of the primary two ways of attaining wilaya, taqwa and iman. Only iman alone would make you a mu'min. But then to become a wali, a friend of Allah, you need iman and taqwa coupled with it. And taqwa is just not fear of Allah. You can't translate it as fear of Allah. It has a much broader meaning. Taqwa comes from waqa yaqi wiqaya, which means to protect oneself. To put up a barrier to protect yourself from the ghadab of Allah, from the anger of Allah. This is what taqwa is all about. Umar radiallahu anhu, the genius, he asked Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, Ya Ubay, define taqwa for me. Ubay radiallahu anhu asked him, Ya Umar radiallahu anhu, have you ever walked down a thorny path? He says, yes, I have. Then what did you do as you were walking down a thorny path? He said, I gathered my clothes together, I took extreme precaution because I did not want to snag my clothes on those thorns. I did not want to harm myself by pricking myself on those thorns. And I took precaution and I moved down that path. That path, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is this life that we are traversing upon. It is a transitory stage. It is a stage to prepare yourself for your destination, for your goal, which is Akhirah. And taqwa is that which will get you from point A to point B, peacefully and safely. And taqwa is all about staying away from all that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. Complying to the commandments of Allah, staying away from all that which He has prohibited. Allah the Almighty says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. Allah did not say, do not indulge in fornication. Allah said, do not even get close to the act of fornication. Imam Ibn Qayyim, rahimahullah, he mentions in his book, Rawdatul Muhibbin, the garden of the lovers. Look at the book. The garden of the lovers, Allahu Akbar. He mentions in Rawdatul Muhibbin, he says that in regard to zina, in regard to fornication and adultery, it is a trap, it is a sin, it is a trap, it is a deep pit where one, if he were to fall in that, Allah save us all, if he were to fall in that sin, he would move from sin after sin. He would retrogress, he would go worse and worse from sin after sin, from evil to evil. He would disobey his parents. He would lose his wife. He would lose his children. He would lose his family. He would lose his wealth. And he would be deprived of all of Allah's blessings. All of Allah's blessings. The one who falls into the pit of zina, he loses everything. He becomes a loser in this world and the hereafter. If he is married, he is not even worthy to walk on the face of this earth. He should be stopped. This is the hukum. Taqwa is something that keeps you away. He says, fornication, the means that get you to fornication. You should stay away from every single thing that would lead you to fornication, towards zina, towards adultery. You should take precaution not to fall into the pit holes that would put you into the pit of zina. Allah save us all. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, now in regard to Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, which is the mercy of Allah the Almighty, Allah, our beloved Creator, He brings about a surah by itself which talks about His mercy. Allah. He brings about, this is such a beautiful surah. See, many of us at times, we don't know some small surahs, but yet we know Suratul Rahman. For Suratul Rahman has reserved a special place in everyone's heart. In every slave of Allah's heart, in every slave of Allah, Suratul Rahman has reserved a special place. For the surah by itself, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, completely, from the beginning to the end, talks about the mercy of Allah the Almighty. Allahu Akbar. It talks about the mercy of Allah the Almighty. Allah starts the surah, Ar-Rahman. Allah did not start it saying, Allah is Ar-Rahman, or Allah is the most merciful, Allah is the most compassionate, Allah is the most beneficent. Allah did not start the surah as such. Rather, Allah started Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, the most compassionate, the most beneficent. The reason being, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah wants to highlight that there is nothing, nothing other than I am merciful. There is nothing, no words to explain the mercy of our Creator. No words at all. Allahu Akbar. And this, from the very same root comes Silatul Rahim. Silatul Rahim. You know, in the Arabic language, Ar-Rahim means the womb of a mother. And Silatul Rahim means maintaining relationship, you know, family ties. Maintaining family ties. And this breaks off from the hadith that I said in the beginning, Irhamu man fil ard, yarhamukum man fis sama. Have mercy amongst you all, amongst one another. And Silatul Rahim is something which has been emphasized. Maintaining your kinship, your family ties, is something that has been extremely emphasized in our religion, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. For the rahmah of Allah has been divided into 100 parts. 100 parts. And 100, one part of it has been sent to this dunya. And it is through that one part that a mother looks after her children, that animals look after their young ones, that husband and wife love one another. Mother loves the children, father loves the children, children love their parents. You see all of these manifestations of love through that one part. And on the day of Qiyamah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty has reserved 99 for Him. And on that day, even that one part which He sent to this earth, He would also lift that up to Him, make it 100, complete the 100, and He would have 100 waiting for Him, waiting for us to forgive us. And it is due to that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, because Allah the Almighty removes even that 100th away from us. This is why on the day of Qiyamah, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. Today your wife is everything to you. She is your beloved. Your children are everything to you. But on that day, a husband will run away from his wife. Children will run away from their parents. Why? Because even that 100th has been taken away. Allah will lift that away from their hearts. Family members will run away from one another on that horrifying day. Ya nafsi, they will only be worried about their soul. The reason being, Allah the Almighty lifts that 100th to Him, makes it 100, completes the rahmah, and He keeps it for us. To the believers on the day of Qiyamah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And coming back to Silatul Rahim. Now this 100 which Allah the Almighty sent to us, you look at the eagle. The eagle which builds its nest on the tops of mountains. It is a bird, a magnificent bird that can soar up in the heavens. It builds its nest on the tops of mountains, in the peaks of mountains, the cliffs of mountains. It lays its eggs, and once the eggs hatch, it swoops from the top of the mountain down below to get food for its young, and goes and feeds the young ones. And when the time comes when the young ones have grown, the eagle, the mother, now trains the young ones to fly. And how to fly? To soar in the air. You know the way the eagles fly are different. They don't fly like crows. Crows can't go up to that height. But the eagle, it teaches its young ones how to fly. Once the young ones learn to fly, they fly away. They forget their mother, they forget their father, and they fly away. They never ever come back. They never come back. They fly away. They forget their mother and father and fly away. But look at the difficulty the mother eagle and the father eagle went through. But on the other hand, human beings are not like that. You still love your grandfather. You still love your grandmother. You have grown to become a strong man now. But that doesn't mean you can forget your mother, forget your father, forget your grandfather, forget your grandmother. No! Silatul Rahim is not for the animals. It is not for the animals, but it is for us. And only by bonding ties, by acting upon the hadith, Irhamu man fil ard, will we win the mercy of Allah the Almighty. Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, and once again in regard to Surah Ar-Rahman, It is a surah. Every ayah in the surah talks about the mercy of Allah the Almighty. Every ayah. Every ayah. Every ayah somehow or the other shows the mercy of Allah the Almighty. Like I said, Allah begins the surah Ar-Rahman. The very next ayah, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ. Allah says, Ar-Rahman, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ. He is the one who has taught us Al-Qur'an. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, knowledge is something vital. Vital for every human being. And understand this, that around us, you can look around yourself and you could see different things. If I were to ask you, what are the bounties of Allah that you see around you, you could come up with different things. You could say this and you could say that. Allah the Almighty says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to try to enumerate and count the blessings of Allah the Almighty, you would fail. You would fail miserably. You would not be able to count the blessings of Allah the Almighty. You could start, you could say oxygen, you could say water, you could say the trees, you could say life by itself. Every single thing, whether it be positive or whether it be negative, is a mercy and blessing from Allah the Almighty. At times we don't understand the negative part of it. A hardship, a trial, a calamity, an affliction that you go through, that is also a manifestation of the mercy of Allah the Almighty. Allahu Akbar. You enter a deal, a business deal, saying a lie. You say a lie and you enter a deal. You're raking in the profits in the millions. You think, but then what happens? Something goes wrong in the deal and you lose millions. You lose millions. That is a mercy from Allah the Almighty, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. It is a blessing in disguise. Number one, it is to expiate you for the crime, for the lie that you said. And number two, it is a message from your beloved maker to make you turn to him. To make you understand, oh, what I did was wrong. You know, these millions are not worth it. What I did was wrong. And the next time I do a deal, I should do it the halal way. For you earn 1,000 rupees haram, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. That 1,000 rupees would eat away all of your money. You would suddenly be wondering your bank account is running minus in the millions. And then you're wondering, what did I do wrong? It is your haram income, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. It is your haram income. The figures and the digits can go long, but the barakah is taken away. A person who earns 10,000 rupees in a source of income which is halal, the things that he could do, you who is earning it through haram income, you would not be able to do it with even 100,000 or a million for that matter. You wouldn't know how and where your money is going. These are messages from Allah the Almighty. Allah afflicts you with a sickness, a terminal disease. It is a blessing in disguise. It is to make you turn towards Him. Even a fever, it is to forgive your sins. Even a slight headache, it is to forgive your sins. It is to make you closer to Allah the Almighty. Every single thing that is positive and negative around us, all of them are blessings of Allah the Almighty, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. But in comparison to all of those blessings, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, my beloved teacher, he says, that divine knowledge, not secular knowledge, divine knowledge, in regard to the Sharia, in regard to the Deen, in regard to the Quran and the Hadith, it is a blessing that is so important that a person, an individual, should attach importance to it more than the importance he attaches to water, food and shelter. Allahu Akbar. This is how important, and this is where the ulama of Salafun Salih place the divine knowledge, the knowledge in regard to Allah the Almighty, the knowledge in regard to His divine attributes, the knowledge in regard to His speech, the Quran, the knowledge in regard to the hadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he says a very beautiful statement. I'll wrap it up with that. He says, this is in his book Risala. He says, he's a giant, Allahu Akbar. He's the giant of our madhhab. He says that I thank Almighty Allah for all of the blessings that He has blessed me with. I thank Almighty Allah for all of the blessings that He has blessed me with. And me getting to thank Almighty Allah, that is a separate blessing of Allah the Almighty that I need to make thanks once again for. You with me? I thank Allah the Almighty for all the blessings that He has blessed me with. And me getting to thank Allah the Almighty, Allah granting me tawfiq, Allah giving me the opportunity to thank Him for those blessings, is another blessing that I need to make separate thanks for. So for it is only through the tawfiq, for it is only through the blessing of Allah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that we get such opportunities, where we get to turn to Allah the Almighty. Allah says when He describes Himself, Noorun ala noor, yahdi Allahu li noorihi man yasha. Allah guides towards His light the one He wishes. Don't think that it is out of your capability or it is out of our capability that we are seated here and we are discussing about Allah the Almighty. It is not through our talent or our capability. It is through the tawfiq of Allah. It is a blessing of Allah. Allah says, La in shakartum la azidannakum. If you thank Allah the Almighty, if you turn to Him in gratitude and thanks, La azidannakum. We shall increase. We shall give you in an abundance. You make shukr, the more you make shukr, the more you will get. The more you complain, the more you grumble. La in kafartum inna azabi la shadeed. Same ayah. La in shakartum la azidannakum wa la in kafartum. On the other hand, if you, one of the meanings of kufr, another meaning for kufr is also to be ungrateful. Kufr. Wala in kafartum. Kufr. Same kufr. Is to reject Allah the Almighty and be ungrateful. If you are ungrateful towards Him, then know, inna adhabi la shadeed. My punishment is severe. You grumble, you complain, you blame Allah the Almighty, then you start seeing trials, calamities, afflictions coming from every corner. All punishments of Allah the Almighty, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. We are wallowing in the mercy of Allah the Almighty. We are immersed in the mercy of Allah the Almighty. And if we do not thank Him, we are not fit to call ourselves the slaves of Allah. We can never attain the stages of wilayah. We can never become the friend of Allah, from the awliya of Allah. For it is only through understanding the bounties of Allah and thanking Him for every single bounty, for His mercy, for His rahmah, can we get closer and closer to Him. So with that I conclude. And inshallah ta'ala, there will be a continuation of the same names, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, in the coming session too. May Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. And may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our good deeds. May Allah the Almighty keep on showing His mercy towards us. May Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq to do a'mal, salihah, to do good deeds, to participate in gatherings where the angels shroud us. And Allah the Almighty makes high mention of us in the heavens. And may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah, just as how He unites us here. وآخر دعوايا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته جزاكم الله خير في الاسم الشكر